Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's a pleasure to be with you this morning again. And, you know, it's a real challenge for me to speak and to preach in English, you know. And so this is one of the reasons, especially I need to bow to my Father in heaven so that he can help me and he can bless us too during this moment. Our Father in heaven, we are so thankful to be your children, and we are so thankful to be here to share your word and to hear your word of righteousness, your word of truth. And right now, during this hour, we want to hear your word of truth. And we would like to be filled of your spirit. And so we ask you to be with us and to lead us. And I ask you especially to be with me, to use my tongue as it should be. And I ask you to anoint me with your spirit so that I can speak your word in the way you want me to speak them. And it's in Jesus Christ that I ask you all these things. Amen.
Amen.
How many of us profess a religion? All of us, I think. You have probably already been asked the question, what is your religion? And what did you answer? Maybe that you have given the name of one of the 20,780 Christian denominations identified in 1980 in the World Christian Encyclopedia by David Barrett. But what answer would Jesus have given to this question? Or if you prefer, what answer does the Bible give to these questions? I would like to invite you to open your Bible with me in James. Where are we going right now?
James,
right, that's right. James chapter 1. James chapter 1. And we're going to read there verse 27, where he said, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction and to keep himself unspotted from the world. Whatever the religion that we may profess, friends, we need to know that the pure and undefiled religion before God consists in two things. First of all, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and secondly, to, if I speak for myself, to keep myself unspotted from the world. I'm not stay too long on the first point, but I just want to say a few things upon it. To visit comes from the Greek word episkeptomai, and this word means or could mean to relieve. Okay, so it's not only, you know, to go to someone's home and to say, oh, I visit him, you know? And I stayed with my hand before my back like that. And I said, oh, I visit him, you know? This is a good thing to visit someone. But the Bible tells us that we need to relieve these people. And the second point is to keep myself unspotted from the world. What is the world?
Lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life.
Thank you, brother. Let us go to, but I would like to share with you another statement. And let's go quickly in James chapter 4. And we're going to read there James 4. And we're going to read there, starting from verse 4. Ye adulterers and adulteress, knew ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Okay? And do you think that, verse 5, the scripture saith, in vain the spirit that dwelleth in us lust to envy and envy, but he giveth more grace. Wherefore, he saith, God resists the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Okay? Amen. So submit yourself, therefore, to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. So, the world, my friends, corresponds to the principles and practice that are contrary to the will of God, such as sin. And this is a word that we can use for that. And I just want you to notice something, that the word pure before religion in James 1, verse 27, that word comes from or was translated from the Greek word katharos, okay? And I ask you to keep that in mind, okay? Katharos is the dilemma for the word translated by pure. So God expects us to be able to do his will, that is to overcome sin. Do you think that this is possible, friends?
God, anything is possible.
Do you think that this is possible to you? Because there is two questions.
Yes. Yeah.
Do you think that this is possible? Oh, this is possible, but for someone else. But do you think that this is possible for you, for me, for us?
You Christ, yes.
You know, some of the teachers who claim to prepare a people for the second return of Jesus says that they say that you cannot overcome sin. Taylor G. Burch in the Ministry magazine of December 1965, in page 9, said that we should remember that only when Jesus comes can we be made perfect. And another minister who worked in the same religion like him, Mr. Maurice L. Vanden, in Faith That Works, page 175 in the version of 1980, he says that we are sinners. We will be sinners until Jesus comes, and sinners cannot produce obedience. All we can do is to give up ever hoping to produce any real obedience. This is shocking to you, I think.
Pleasing to many.
Yes, that's not good.
How many of us are believers in the truth about God?
Yes.
And this is a shock for you when you read that. But let me tell you, in our movement, people are teaching that.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
People are teaching, there are false teachers who are saying that, you know, sin is the human nature. And basically, they are saying the same thing. Yeah. And most of us know who are these people. And I won't give names here. So these teachers, all of these teachers who promote this religion, says that as human beings, we cannot overcome sin. And that we'll continue to sin until the second coming of Christ. But what does the Bible say about that? And especially, how this issue is related to our study of Daniel 8, 14 and 9. Yesterday, we laid the foundation of our study of Daniel 8, 14 and 9. And in that first part of our presentation, we saw that Daniel 8, 14 tells us that at the end of the 2,300 years, the sanctuary will be cleansed or justified. Okay? Or if you prefer, vindicated. And secondly, we established that this justification or vindication of the sanctuary means the justification or vindication of God's kingdom from the proud questioning of Lucifer against God's way. And today, we're going to continue to dig deep these verses in order to understand how experience on this earth is involved in the vindication of God's kingdom. You know, as I said yesterday, several times the Bible tells us about the vindication of God. And I would like just to remind you some verses that we took yesterday. In Psalm 19, verse 9, we read that the fear of the Lord is clean, tahir, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteousness, tzadik, altogether. And in Psalm 51, verse 4, against thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mayest be justified, tzadik, when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest. The reason why David was so concerned about the righteousness or the vindication of God is because he knew that God could not justify the wicked. Indeed, in Exodus, where are we going to go now? Okay, in Exodus chapter 23. And verse 7. Exodus 23, verse 7. Keep thee far from a false matter, and the innocent and righteous slay thou not, for I will not justify the wicked. And here, justify comes from tzadik also. So, David's concern about God's righteousness was due to his knowledge that God could not justify the wicked. And Daniel, the prophet, was also concerned about that in Daniel chapter 9. And I would like you to turn with me in Daniel chapter 9 right now, please. And we're going to read several verses in that chapter related to that point. And the word that's, okay, I'll tell you that in a few moments. First of all, let's start with verse 7. O Lord, righteousness, and here the word is tzedakah, okay? Tzedakah, it's come from tzedak, okay? So it's another word related to tzedak. So, O Lord, righteousness belongs unto thee, but unto us confusion of faces, as at this day, to the men of Judah, and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and unto all Israel that are near and that are far off, through all the countries whither thou hast driven them, because of their trespass that they have trespassed against thee. And there is also the verse 16 of Daniel 9. O Lord, according to all thy tzedakah, righteousness, I beseech thee, let thy anger and thy fury be turned away from the city Jerusalem, thy holy mountain, because for our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem and thy people are become a reproach to all thou art about us. And there is also verse 18 of that same chapter, where we read where Daniel in his prayer was saying, O my God, unclean thy ear, thank you so much, thy ear, and hear, open thy eyes, and behold our desolations, and the city which is called by thy name, for we do not present our supplications before thee for our tzedakah, righteousness, but for thy great mercies. In all these verses, Daniel is contrasting the righteousness of God with the unrighteousness of Israel. And it was in order to complete his message given in Daniel 8:14 that Gabriel stated what we read in Daniel 9 verse 24. Now, let us read that verse. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint it, and to anoint the most holy. The expression make reconciliation come from kufar, okay? And this is the same word that are translated by shall make atonement in Leviticus 4, verse 26 and 31 that we read yesterday. And that's why yesterday we said that at the cross, a atonement was made, okay? There was an atonement at the cross. And this atonement is the reconciliation, friends, okay? And just to let you know also that the word everlasting righteousness here it's tzedek. It's another word related to tzedak, okay? So everlasting righteousness. But we're going to have a closer look in a few moments. But I just want you to notice that because of what we said about make reconciliation. By his vicarious sacrifice on the cross, Christ provided reconciliation for all who accept that sacrifice. And interestingly, this verse also mentioned the everlasting righteousness. I'd like to ask you a question right now. What is this everlasting righteousness? Before considering this, I'd like you to notice the words right before everlasting righteousness. Because it is said to bring in everlasting righteousness. To bring in everlasting righteousness. The term translated by bring in Daniel 9:24 comes from the Hebrew word bo. And this word bo could mean to enter, come to bring, lead in, gather in, to be brought. So we need to understand that Christ did not come to this earth simply to provide for the blotting out of our sin, but he came to reconcile men to God in making this everlasting righteousness available to every man. And having established this point, I'd like to show you now how the prophetic words of Daniel 8:14 and Daniel 9:24 teach us about the way that God's kingdom will be vindicated. By the way, this is a beautiful chart, right? And you know, by the way, yesterday I was searching, you know, on Google Image a chart, and I don't know why, but I fall on that chart, and when I look at it, and I really appreciate it, but once I look at it, I saw that this chart come from Smyrna. Okay, so I just realized that how brothers here are doing pretty good job, you know. So praise the Lord. But let us return to our study. So my point was that according to Daniel 8:14, the period of time, the 2,300 years is the period of time that we have to wait for the justification of God's kingdom. But according to Daniel 9:24, the 70 weeks are the period of time which is related to the justification of men. So the message in the prophetic message of this prophecy is that the justification of men is a part of the justification of God's kingdom, friends. Did you get this? And this understanding is confirmed by Paul in Romans chapter 3, verse 25 and 26. Are we going to go now? Okay, let's turn there. Romans chapter 3, verse 25 and 26. Whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. To declare, I said, at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believe in Jesus. So you see, this message of Paul, the truth that Paul was teaching here, or he's teaching here, is explained in the prophetic message, the way that the message, the prophetic message was given to Daniel. And having established this point, I'd like to show you Or I should say to remind you, you know, something fundamental, you know. The righteousness of God. The Bible tells us in 1 John 5:17 that unrighteousness is sin. And in 1 John 3, verse 4, that sin it's equal to the transgression of the law. Thus, unrighteousness, it's equal to the transgression of the law. And if we reverse it, righteousness, it's equal to the obedience to the law. This, my friends, is a fundamental understanding. Because you see, with this fundamental understanding, you have no room to say that sin is the human nature, because this is not the definition that the Bible gives of sin, I would say. So once you are wrong on the understanding of the righteousness, the understanding of sin, the definition of sin, you're going to be wrong on your understanding of the righteousness of God and the way to get that righteousness. So we need to be sure that we understand these things. The everlasting righteousness of Daniel 9:24 is the righteousness mentioned in Psalm 119 and verse 142. And I would like to invite you to turn with me there. And this will confirm just what we show here. Where are we gonna go?
142.
That's right. And there we read, "Thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and thy law is the truth." Here we have two expressions which in fact relate to the same thing, which is the law of God is truth, and the same law is the everlasting righteousness. Because do you know why? God's law is everlasting. God's law is eternal. God's law doesn't change, because God doesn't change.
God's law is his character.
Of course. Amen, brother. So, how Christ bringing this everlasting righteousness in our life, how Christ will do that? First of all, I'd like to show you this in connection to God's kingdom. So let's go to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. Where are we going? Okay. Hebrews 4:16. And there we read, "Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Again, a throne implies a kingdom, right? So the throne of grace represents the kingdom of grace, right? And since those who are seated on the throne of grace are the same who are seated on the throne of glory, that is God and His Son, it follows that the citizens of the kingdom of grace are also the citizens of the kingdom of glory. In other words, men must first become citizens of the kingdom of grace in order to become citizens of the kingdom of glory. So, the true question now is how men could become citizens of the kingdom of grace. This is a true question here. Let's consider what the Apostle Paul says in Ephesians 2, verse 8. Are we going to go now? Okay. And there we read, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God." Salvation is due to God's grace, my friends. Which one? God's grace is an undeserved favor that He asked to men to grasp, to accept by the mean or the arm of faith. And it's through that process that we get justification, according to what we read in Romans 5, verse 1 and 2. Are we going to go now? That's right. Romans 5, 1 and 2. And there we read. Romans 5, 1 and 2. "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God." Notice how justification is here related to faith. In writing in verse 1, being justified by faith, Paul implies that justification is the state in which faith brings us into. And now, in verse 2, the apostle says that the grace in which we stand is accessible by faith. It follows, therefore, that that standing or to stand in the grace is equal to the fact of being justified. And friends, when we stand in God's grace, in God's justice, this means that we no longer sin. And, you know, many times people, you know, they, especially the evangelical Christian, they said, "Oh, we are under grace, we are no longer under the law." But when we are under grace, friends, it means that we are in this state, in this process, in this plan of God of justification. So there is no room to think that under, be under the be be under the grace of God's kingdom means that there is no law. No, we are free from to do everything that we want. That's wrong. That's pretty wrong. And I'd like to give you the word of Paul in Romans 6, 14 to 18. Where are we going to go? Romans 6, 14 to 18. Because Paul confirms that, what I just said. Romans 6, 14 to 18. For sin shall no have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are no under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servant to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness? But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. You know? So this is clear. This is clear. Thus, by faith, we grasp God's grace, which brings us into his righteousness. And it's in standing there that we get total victory over sin, which culminates in our salvation. And this is how the citizenship of the kingdom of grace is obtained. And, you know, Paul also tells us more about how Christ bringing this everlasting righteousness in our life. I would like to invite you to go with me in Romans 4, and to read verse 3 to 5. Are we going to go now? Okay. For what saith the scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Now, to him that worketh is the reward, not reckoned of grace, but of debt. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. So here, what we learn here, it's that justification gives to the repentant sinner the right to enter the highway of the kingdom and travel there. Because here it was a process and instantaneous. Do you catch this? Instantaneous process with Abraham. So this gives this the justification that which Paul of which Paul is speaking here. It's the rights given to enter the highway of the kingdom. But this justification here, mentioned here, does not provide the power to make progress upon it. So here it's what we call the justification imputed, okay, in other place of the scripture. And in order to make progress upon the highway of the kingdom, we need the power. We need the power of Christ. We need Christ in us, the indwelling of Christ, so that we can say in with Paul, if I live, it's not me, but Christ in me. Okay? So, and when we entered in that process, we entered into the righteousness or the justice imparted. And in fact, when we talk about justice imparted, we are talking of sanctification. Let us read that in, let's go back to Romans 6 and let's read verse 19. Are we going to go now? And there, we're going to see that this bringing in of justification imparted is in fact the sanctification. Romans 6 verse 19, where we read, I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye have yielded your members servant to uncleanness and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness. So you see that? Paul here is comparing, and here in his comparison, he is saying that holiness is a kind of righteousness. And this righteousness that he's speaking about is the imparted righteousness, is that we receive in ourselves, you know. It's not the instantaneous. Could you repeat that for me?
Instantaneous?
Yeah. Thank you so much. I come from France, sorry.
That's okay.
the instantaneous process. Yeah, sorry. Get it. So, as faith is exercised, we are able to receive more and still more of the righteousness of God until faith becomes a permanent attitude toward Him, until righteousness. We are growing in righteousness through faith. And that's why the apostle was saying, he said, from faith to faith. Okay? So that's why. Friends, God's purpose in the plan of salvation is not only our forgiveness. That is our justification. It's not only that. God's plan, the full plan of God, the complete version of that software of God, is to restore us, to sanctify us. And you know, that is the experience that all those who apply for the citizenship of God's kingdom must have since 1844. I repeat that. This is the experience that all those who apply for the citizenship of God's kingdom must have since 1844. It's not an option, my friend.
Amen.
It's not an option.
That's right.
It's not an option, because God's kingdom have to be vindicated. And how experience is involved in that vindication of God's kingdom. And the reason why I am telling you that we need to have this experience, it's a mandatory experience since 1844, it's because in Malachi chapter 3, verse 3 and 4, where are we going to go now?
Malachi 3 and 4.
That's right. We read about the coming of Christ, not on earth, but in the sanctuary, and especially in the most holy place of the sanctuary. And there we have a work, a special work, which is mentioned. Malachi 3, verse 3 and 4. And he shall sit as a refiner, that is, okay, I will read it, and just after I will explain. And he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. And he shall purify the son of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. Then shall the offering of Judah and Jerusalem be pleasant unto the Lord, as in the day of old, and as in former years. Yesterday we read that verse, right? Do you remember that?
Yes.
And yesterday we established that purifier and purify comes from taher,
right.
Okay? And righteousness comes from tzedak. So here, the Bible tells us that when Christ entered into the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, he is doing that work. He will do that work in those who are on earth. And do you remember also what we saw yesterday when I was speaking about the Septuagint version? And I know that some of you were confused of that, because I was explaining many, many things. But in the Septuagint version, in Leviticus 16, verse 30, and Daniel 8, 14, this version is in Greek. And the Greek word used for cleanse in both instances, what word it is? Do you remember that? Katharizo. Okay? And this is the word that Paul used in Hebrew 9:23. Are we going to go now? Hebrew 9:23. It was, Hebrews 9:23, it was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified. And should be purified here is katharizo, okay? It translates from katharizo. Should be purified with this, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than this. So, notice here that there is a purification. The pattern have to be purified. But we have also this word mentioned in verse 14 of the same chapter. Daniel, Hebrew 9, verse 14. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the everlasting Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Here, shall purge comes from katharizo. And we have also this teaching of Paul in Hebrew 10, verse 2. Hebrew 10, verse 2. Hebrew 10, verse 2, and there we read, for then would they not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers once purged should have had no more conscience of sins. And here also purged comes from katarizio. Here the apostle is speaking about the purging, or if you prefer, the cleansing of our conscience. And what is the conscience? What is the conscience that we have? It's the psychological faculty that distinguishes between right and wrong. And what Christ, the work of Christ in heaven right now, has an effect and should have an effect in the conscience of those who are preparing themselves for his return. So what goes on in heaven must happen in our life, in our life. And I am saying that because in Exodus 25 verse 8, do you know what is teach here? Can you speak loudly? They shall make me a sanctuary and I will
dwell
among them. I will dwell among them. And what, can you tell me what the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians 6 verse 19? We are the temple of the Spirit. We are the temple of God's Spirit. So, what goes on in heaven, friends, right now? The vindication of God's kingdom, the final atonement. It's, you know, it's related to what goes on in God's people. What goes on in heaven must happen also on earth, in God's temples. So it's not an option. It's not an option for us since 1844 to live, to have this experience. It's not an option. This is something that God expects us to experiment. Because, why? Because it's possible to experiment it. And this is a good news. Amen. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
I say amen to that. This is a good news, friends. And, you know, Psalm 77, verse 13. Yesterday we read it. Sister Han, you remember? God's way, thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Okay. I would like to invite you to turn with me in Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 25. Are we going to go now? That's right. Ezekiel 18, 25. Remember that thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Remember that. Okay. 18, 25 in Ezekiel. Yet ye say, the way of the Lord is not equal. Hear now, O house of Israel, is not my way equal? Are not your ways unequal? And let us read verse 29 right now. Yet saith the house of Israel, the way of the Lord is not equal. O house of Israel, are not my ways equal? Are not your ways unequal? You know, God's way is righteous, right?
Yes.
And God's way is in his sanctuary. But God has a problem, because if he do nothing, his people, Israel, will have an experience which will says that God's way is unequal. That God's way is not equal. But once we enter into the experience of the everlasting atonement, the final atonement, sorry, I'm getting tired. Once we entered into the experience of the final atonement, we will be no longer like the Israel mentioned here. We will be no longer like the Israel mentioned here, because in Revelation 15 verse 3 we read, are we going to go now? 15 verse 3. And there will be the experience of the spiritual Israel, the true Israel of God. And we're going to read the expression of their experience. Revelation 15 verse 3. And they sing, who are they? What are they?
The 144.
Thank you. And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints. You know, this is the thing that God wants us to experiment. To live that mind, to live that attitude, which leads us to say by our lives that God's way is unequal. And only those who will experiment, friends, this the final atonement. Only those in whom the final atonement will have its effect can have this experience, and consequently could be among the 144,000. Again, the subject of the sanctuary and the investigative judgment should be clearly understood by the people of God. All need a knowledge for themselves of the position and work of their great high priest. Otherwise, it will be impossible for them to exercise the faith which is essential at this time, or to occupy the position which God designed them to fill. After having presented this topic, are you able to have a better understanding of that? Yes. We should.
Yes.
We should. Because God wants us to occupy a special position, friends, right now, today, since 1844. And I'm sorry to have to say this, but Lira Froom, Till R. G. Bunch, Maurice Vanden, and all the fallen angels in our movement who are teaching a different message than this message. They are preventing us to vindicate God's kingdom. They are preventing God's people to vindicate his kingdom. And, you know, sometime in this message that we call the truth about God, I can hear a lot of confusion, a lot of confusing thoughts. And, you know, we have to be bold right now. And we should be bold right now. Because if what we call the truth about God is something without this, I tell you, this truth about God is not, it's a vain religion. Yes. This truth about God that peoples are promoting on the earth, yeah, it's not the pure and undefiled religion. Mm-hmm. And I don't want that, friends. Mm-hmm. And I think that you too, you don't want that. So we need to hold firm. We need to hold firm to what God gave us as message. And we need to investigate it. We need to investigate that message. And we need to have this experience so that God's ways can be in us so that we can vindicate his kingdom. Yes. Amen. Let us pray.
Amen.
Our Father in heaven, we are so thankful because of your word of truth. And in your word, you gave us everything that we need right now for our times. And now we are living in the time of the end. And you send us the present truth so that we can investigate it, so that we can understand it and experiment that truth for today. And I ask you, with all of my brothers and sisters and the friends who are here with me right now, and those who are online, and those who will watch this record, I ask you to lead us in your way. Lead us in your righteousness through Christ, by faith, so that we can have this experience today, so that we can be the kind of people that you want us to be, where you want us to be. And I pray thee in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.